Yeah, so in this session of numerical methods, I like to talk a little bit about the convergence rate of the Euler scheme. So we were in this section on time discretization of stochastic processes. Maybe we can repeat this code part here from the last session. So actually we were doing an Euler scheme for a very simple log normal process. And if you just look to the first column, yeah, our observation was that actually there are some problems for the first values here. It's because the Euler scheme generates negative values for the stock. Yeah, so the logarithm of S is not a number. Yeah. So the Euler scheme of a log normal can generate negative values, but the process we know should be positive, yeah, so non-negative. And then you see that the scheme converges. So this delta M here is the error on the mean. We know the mean analytically, so we can check for this error. And you also see that if you take, this is the number of time steps, if you double the number of time steps, you get approximately half the error. So we already observed in this little experiment that we have some kind of convergence which looks like of order 1 divided by n. N is the number of time steps. So this is the convergence when we compare the expectation of the logarithm of the true solution to the expectation of the logarithm of the Euler scheme solution. So this is a specific metric which we use. Yeah. So compare the expectation of a function of the solution. And today I would like to discuss exactly this this topic. Yeah, the convergence of the Euler scheme. So we already discussed Euler scheme, Hilstein scheme, log Euler, and let's jump to this section on the convergence rate. So we consider convergence in terms of the number of time discretization steps. Okay, so maybe this is not the correct object that defines the limit. So what's the object first? What's the object that defines the limit? So we consider time discretization. So given here a sequence of time discretizations, like in the code example, yeah, we had different time discretization, making it finer and finer. I now have a sequence of time discretizations. So these are my time discretizations, and we have a sequence because I have a parameter n telling me how many discretization points do we use. Actually, we use n plus 1 discretization points, so we have n intervals. And this n defines a specific time discretization, so which becomes possibly finer and finer. So these discretizations are discretizing the interval from 0 to n, from 0 to t, sorry, for some fixed time horizon t. So we consider the convergence only on a fixed interval. We look at the fixed interval from 0 to capital T and would like to know, does the Euler scheme approximation converge to the true solution of the SDE? So, and as you maybe already know, yeah, the number of time discretization points is maybe not the correct thing that defines the convergence, yeah, because you can take many points in one region and have very few points in the other region, a little bit like the discrepancy, yeah, where we like to fill random numbers, yeah, but now we are on the time axis here. So the object which we look at for defining the convergence So let's take a different color here. So we define the convergence in terms of the time step size. So the time step size, we take the maximum time step size, Hn. So each discretization Ti superscript n, yeah, for all I, yeah. So each discretization labeled with the n has a maximum time step size, and we like to have this time step size go to zero. So we look at a convergence in terms of the time step size. So this defines the limit. The limit we are looking at. So given a time discretization where the time step size goes to zero, we have convergence of the Euler scheme. So what was the Euler scheme? Let's repeat it here. So we look at the convergence of the Euler scheme of a stochastic process. So there is dx of t is mu of t x of t dt, sigma of t x of t dw with some given functions mu and sigma. So the coefficients in front of dt and dw can be stochastic processes in the sense that they depend on x. Yeah, the coefficient depends on x, so the coefficients itself could be a random variable, but it is a function, a deterministic function, mu and sigma. So these are this is an ITER process, and for that process, we now consider the Euler scheme using the time discretization T superscript n. Yeah, so we are here using our time discretization Ti superscript n for the Euler scheme discretization. Okay, and this defines then an Euler scheme approximation x tilde. So I was always denoting the approximation with a tilde, and also a superscript n, because for every discretization I have maybe a different solution. Yeah, so like in our code example, yeah, where we had finer and finer steps, we get different solutions. And you see that this here is just the Euler scheme. The next value is the previous value plus mu evaluated at the previous value, yeah, and the previous time step, times a fixed time step delta Ti, plus sigma evaluated at the previous time step and also the previous value, times the Brownian increment. Yeah? Brownian increment, you know, this is a normal distributed random variable, and all delta WTIs superscript n are independent. Okay, maybe there's a little bit missing here on the page. Yeah, so what about the initial value? So the initial value here, x of zero, should be x subscript zero. And of course, the Euler scheme starts at the same initial value. Yeah, so otherwise, we would have an error from the beginning. And looking at the convergence doesn't make much sense. Yeah, so also please add here the x tilde in zero is the same initial value. Okay, so this is now what we are looking at. So x tilde superscript n converges to x. So actually, you know that the yellow line is just a short notation for maybe copy this. Yeah. So this here is a short notation. For x at a later point is the initial value plus the integral from 0 to t, so this later point, mu of t, x of t, dt plus the stochastic integral, sigma of t, x of t, dw. So in which sense does the Euler scheme converge to this stochastic process? Yeah, this is maybe a bit strange and we have to clarify it. So in which sense does x tilde, so x tilde superscript n, converge to x for actually for what was defining our limit for h superscript n going to zero? Okay, so what we have to do is to define this. And why do we need to define this? So the Euler scheme gives us the stochastic process at discrete points in time. So if there's t0 here, t1 there, t2 there, yeah, I dropped the superscript to actually be a bit quicker. Yeah. So then the Euler scheme gives us, starting from this initial value, the next value here, the next value here, for a specific omega. Yeah. So you for a specific omega means you sample a random number on the delta w, you plug it in into this recursion formula, and you get the next point. Yeah. So this is what the Euler scheme gives us. Maybe the Euler scheme also gives us with a different random number. Yeah. So a different omega. Yeah. So this is maybe the omega 2, whatever, and we have maybe also another one. Okay, so, and the stochastic process the true solution x looks like this. Yeah, so it's somewhere wiggling around here. Yeah, so maybe now for some omega 3. So in which sense does now this converge? So what we do is we define a time continuous, say, interpolation of the x tilde. Okay, so how do we do this? So maybe we could use just a kind of linear interpolation. So let's take the Brown one. Yeah. So let's take something like this. Some kind of linear interpolation. Is it like this? So what we have to do is to do define a time continuous version or interpolation x tilde superscript n of t, because then I have two time continuous stochastic processes and I can look how does the Euler scheme process converge to the true solution x. Okay, so yeah, maybe this idea of doing a linear interpolation is already okay. Yeah, but we will actually do this interpolation a little bit different. And here it is. So the scheme defines x tilde superscript n only at discrete points. And in order to have a time continuous process, what we do is we use the Euler scheme So the next value is the previous value plus mu times time step size plus sigma times Brownian increment for an intermediate point fixing the coefficient. Yeah. So the intermediate point t for t in this interval is just defined by the using the Euler scheme, and instead of the delta t, we have from ti to little t, and instead of the delta w, we have from ti wti to w of t. And we fix, so we freeze the coefficient. So we have constant coefficients and this is a little bit different from a linear interpolation. Okay, so the drift part here is indeed a linear interpolation. Yeah, so I'm interpolating the point zero, yeah, so plus zero, yeah, when t is equal to ti, this is a zero, this is just x tilde of ti, and the point at the end, which is just mu times delta t, I'm doing a linear interpolation. But on the diffusion part, actually the interpolation is not a linear interpolation of the starting value and the end value. The interpolation is just use the Brownian motion. Okay, Brownian motion is a very easy stochastic process. Yeah, we know every increment is normally distributed. So that's our way of defining the time continuous process x tilde of t. Okay, so this is an interpolation. Yeah, so I can write here for little t equals to ti plus one. This agrees with the Euler step. And in between, it's actually, we could also call it a Brownian bridge. Yeah, it's a bridge from the start point to the end point with the Brownian motion. Yeah, so important part here is the interpolation. Uses W of t. So if I go back to the previous slide, yeah, the picture I've drawn here is wrong. Yeah, so it's not the Brown line like this. Yeah, so actually the Brown line will also wiggle around a little bit because there is a Brownian motion walking in between. Yeah, so but the Brownian motion is connecting the points. And it is the same Brownian motion as we would have in the blue curve. Okay, so the blue curve is maybe also already very close. So now, since this is a time continuous stochastic process, if we go back, recall this here is a short notation, we can write down the short notation for this Euler scheme solution. So for x tilde superscript n, we then have that d x tilde superscript n is, so it's actually just an SDE with a constant coefficient, ti superscript n x tilde of ti dt plus sigma ti, so maybe also here the superscript, x tilde ti, everything with this clumsy superscript, dw of t for t in this interval. So I can write my Euler scheme approximation like this, and you see the Euler scheme is just the corresponding SDE with piecewise constant coefficients, where the coefficient that depends on x just uses the endpoint of the previous step as the argument. So now we have defined the two objects. I will show you, we will go through the proof that x tilde superscript n converges to x. We already have discussed what is defining the limit. Now we have to define the metric in which sense becomes x tilde superscript n close to x. Yeah? And we will discuss two different ones. We will discuss strong and weak convergence. So first, recall the definition of strong and weak convergence, and then I will do a few comments on this. Okay. So here's the definition for the strong convergence. So we say that a stochastic process here, we talk about our x tilde superscript n, converges strongly to x. Yeah? So first we look at the difference of the two random variables, x of t and x tilde of t. We take the absolute value of this difference. And the strong thing here is that we take the supremum over all times. Okay, then the thing, supremum of all the differences of the absolute values, of the absolute value of the differences, is a random variable. Okay, it's a non-negative random variable. Yeah, so we just take a look at the expectation of this, and the expectation should go to zero. So there is, it is allowed that there's a null set where there can be a difference, but actually the null set is taken over all times. Yeah, so this is a very strong condition. Yeah. So the object here inside is a random variable, and for this random variable we take the the expectation, so in probability we converge to zero. Okay, so now what I'd like to do later is prove the order of the convergence. So how fast do we go to zero? Yeah? So, and recall that here in our computer experiment, we already had a guess that the order of the convergence is O of 1 over n. Yeah? So whenever you double the number of time steps, you halve the error. Yeah? And for the strong convergence, we define that x tilde converges to x with strong order gamma. Yeah? If we can prove that the error, so our metric, which we have just defined, so the expectation of the supremum of the distance of the two random variables, x of t minus x tilde of t, can be estimated by a constant times time step size to the power of gamma. Okay, time step size to the power of gamma. So in which sense do we converge in terms of the time step size? Next one is weak convergence. So here's the definition of the weak convergence. So we say that x tilde converges weakly to x if, and now there come if some relaxing things. Yeah. So actually, we look only at a fixed point in time. If for any fixed t, okay, it's not the supremum over all times, it's just for a given fixed time. And for any test function, so any Lipschitz continuous function f, we have that the f, so the test function of the random variable at this point in time, and from that the expectation converges to the expectation of the corresponding Euler scheme approximation. Yeah. So here E of f of x of t, yeah, is just a real number, yeah, and this sequence expectation of f of x tilde of n of t converges to the true expectation. So, for example, if you also think of a null set, yeah, here the null set can be different for every time, and so on. And now, again, we have to define some kind of convergence order. Yeah? So if we like to define a convergence order, we say that x tilde converges to x with weak order gamma if for a fixed t, yeah, so for any fixed t, yeah, not for one, yeah, for any fixed t and any Lipschitz continuous function, we find a constant such that our error is smaller than a constant times time step size to the power of gamma. Okay, so a much weaker condition, yeah, only look at the specific time. Yeah? It has to hold for any time, but the test is done for a fixed time. And it has to hold for any function, but the test is then done for a function f. Okay, so weak sounds a little bit weak. Yeah, so maybe strong is more important. Actually, it's vice versa. The weak convergence is actually the one which is important for us. So a small remark here. So if you, for example, consider our application, valuation of a financial derivative, so if you consider the application, yeah, so for example, our application valuation of a financial derivative, so then what do we do when we perform evaluation of a financial derivative? Well, we have a model for a stock, yeah, which models the random variable of the stock. Then maybe, for example, the Black-Scholes model. Yeah, so I had this on a different slide. Yeah, we had this in a different session. Then we have a function applied to this, which is the payoff you get. You get paid that many if the stock has this value. So we have some function of this. So actually in one of these sessions, I called it G. Yeah. So the payoff function, maximum of ST minus K times the discount factor or the deflator. And then the universal pricing theorem tells you that the value, the fair value today is the expectation of this. So you are exactly in this situation. You look at a fixed time, namely the payment time of this financial derivative, or actually the fixing time, yeah, of the financial derivative. So this is a fixed time. And you also have some kind of test function, which is here the payoff. And you take the expectation. Yeah, so this fixed time is of your financial derivative, the maturity of the option. And this test function is maybe the payoff of the option. Yeah, and this expectation gives you, comes from the universal pricing theorem. Yeah, that if you consider replication portfolios, that you can move to the equivalent martingale measure. And the value is a martingale, so today's value is the expectation. Okay, so remark, if you consider the application, now that we like to value a financial derivative, then weak convergence is the one which is of interest. So weak convergence is maybe the one which is more relevant to us. Anyway, I will start today with looking at the strong convergence. Also, if you go back to our small numerical experiment, so what did we do here? Yeah, we were checking the mean, so of the expectation of the logarithm. Yeah, so we're just checking the mean, which is the expectation of the logarithm of S. Yeah, so delta M is the error of the expectation of the logarithm of S. So it's exactly like in the weak convergence. Yeah, expectation of the logarithm of S of T for a fixed T. So from this experiment here, you maybe guess that Euler scheme has weak convergence order 1. Yeah. So 1 over n. Okay. Actually, now I see that it's time step size. It's divided by, it's time step size is 1 divided by n. Yeah. Or actually t divided by n. And so it's order 1. Okay, so now we have defined the two convergence, and we should move to the proof. So to ease a little bit the notation, we will just prove for every of these definitions the second part. We will prove the order, because then the first part follows immediately. Yeah, and for the second part, so here, yeah, for this, I only need to prove an estimate. I can estimate the error, so that part, by a constant times the time step size. So if I prove this estimate for a time step size, then I'm done. So I can actually drop the superscript n. So So what we will do is we prove the convergence x tilde to x by proving the convergence order, and we will prove that we have strong order 1/2 for the order Euler scheme, and as we already guessed from the computer, weak order 1. And for this proof, since we only are interested in proving the estimate, it's sufficient to just look at the estimate, so we do not need this n in the proof. And to ease the notation a little bit, I just now look at a fixed n. Yeah, we look at a fixed n, so, and I write x tilde instead of x tilde superscript n, and I write h instead of hn, and I just write ti instead of ti superscript n. So this makes notation a bit nicer. And then recall that we had already derived or already noticed, yeah, that our Euler scheme is a time continuous stochastic process with piecewise constant coefficient. Yeah, so piecewise constant in the sense that mu ti x tilde ti is conditional to fti, yeah, so a constant. So, and we can even more shorten this notation if we now define piecewise constant functions mu tilde and sigma tilde. So we define here piecewise constant functions. So this is a piecewise constant function where mu tilde of t is just mu of ti x tilde of ti for little t in between ti to ti plus 1. And then my Euler scheme looks even nicer. Yeah, it looks like this. Dx tilde is mu tilde dt plus sigma tilde dw. And mu tilde and sigma tilde are piecewise constant functions on this interval. When we later do the proof, I can decompose an integral into a sum of integrals over these intervals. And then on every such partial integral, I have a constant coefficient. So I cannot give a fully self-contained proof in this session. Yeah. I need to use some results from the theory of stochastic processes. I tried to use only standard results, but I have to do it, and so I have to review a few, three or four results for the proof. I will first prove the strong convergence, and for this I need some estimates from stochastic processes. So let's start with the first lemma, which I need during the proof. If your coefficients behave nicely, if the coefficients of a stochastic process, so this is now just about a stochastic process, then the moments, so the expectation of a power of the stochastic process exists. And also all these lemmas that we are now just recalling here also define some of the requirements of the preconditions for the Euler scheme. So the first precondition which we need is assume that our coefficient function mu and sigma have at most linear growth. Yeah. So that means that there is an estimate or there is a constant C such that mu absolute value is bounded by a constant times 1 plus absolute value of x. So it does not grow faster in x than the linear function, yeah, absolute value of x. And the same holds for sigma. So if you have this property, then for any p larger than 2, larger or equal to 2, you find a constant k. And k can depend on the p, it can depend on the c. It can also depend on our time span from 0 to capital T, because we only look for the convergence on a fixed time span. It, of course, can also depend on the initial value. Yeah, but it does not depend, if we look on the Euler scheme, on h and n. So if you forget a little bit for a moment the Euler scheme part, yeah, then you have the result that the supremum of x to the power of p, yeah, so for 2 it's just the supremum of the variance expressions over all these times here is bounded, yeah, so bounded by this constant k. And we also have the same result for the Euler scheme, yeah, which is actually an easy consequence. And this does not depend on age. Yeah? Okay. Yeah, this, I need this in the proof. And let's have a small remark here. Yeah. So this assumption that we have at most linear growth, yeah, looks strong. Yeah, but maybe it's really reasonable. Yeah, because if you look at an ODE where you have a linear coefficient, for example, dx is rx dt. Yeah, so I'm looking here at an ODE, so there's no dw. Yeah, so it's just for illustration. So then you know that the solution of this is dx by dt is Rx, yeah, so x is the exponential function. So it's x of 0 exponential rt. Yeah? So, and this solution exists for all time. Yeah, so this is okay for all times. This is okay for all t. Now, it grows very fast, but it is. It exists. If you now look, for example, at the ODE, dx is, say, rx squared dt. Yeah, so I have a coefficient which has faster than linear growth. Yeah? So this is the coefficient. This is the mu. Yeah, my mu is now rx squared. Then the solution of this guy is, okay, so what's the solution of this guy? I believe it is 1 divided by 1 divided by x0 plus, no, it's minus rt. Yeah, so in 0 and t equals 0, it's x0. Okay, that is correct. What is the second derivative? The second derivative of 1 divided by something is minus 1 divided by the something squared. So I already see I get an x squared. And then the inner derivative is minus r. So it's plus rx squared. Yeah? Okay, that's the solution. And you see, for example, if you now take x0 to be equal to 1, then this will become infinity at the point t equals 1 divided by r. So this one explodes in finite time. So this explodes in finite time. Yeah. So, and we have a fixed time span. Yeah. So, and this one explodes in finite time. So it could explode within our time interval. And that's maybe not a good stochastic process. So we have here this condition that our coefficients should have at most linear growth. Okay. A next lemma I need is if the coefficients are Lipschitz continuous in both arguments, then we get a similar thing for the stochastic process with respect to the time parameter. So we assume that mu and sigma satisfy a Lipschitz condition in both arguments. So this means if I look at a different point in time and a different point in space, so state space, so Tx and Sy, then I can estimate this with a constant times the distance in time plus the distance in space. And the same holds for sigma. So if I have this condition for my coefficients for mu and sigma for all times and all x and y state points, then we find a constant such that if we look at the difference of the stochastic process x at a point t and x at a point s, and we take, say, the L2 norm or the variance, so the expectation of the square, yeah, then this can be estimated by t minus s. Times some constant k. Yeah? So there is some constant k here in front. And we have some constant. And also we have here the initial value in front. Okay, so if the coefficients, for example, are Lipschitz continuous in time, then if we move a little bit further in time, the stochastic process stays close. Yeah, but think of the Euler scheme, since in the coefficients, there's also the x tilde of t. Yeah, so there is another feedback. Yeah, when you move in time, you also move in space. And this also changes the coefficient again, because of the second argument of the coefficient, the mu of x. Yeah? So you also need this Lipschitz continuity in x. Okay, on the left-hand side, I have an expectation of the distance in a squared. On the right-hand side, I have a time step size without the square. A little bit, this already looks like the convergence in the Euler scheme. Yeah, the Euler scheme freezes the stochastic process at a fixed time. The true solution goes on. And now I look at the difference between the fixed point, the starting point, maybe the S, and the solution went a little bit further over a time step. And on the left-hand side, you see this distance of the two random variables, which could be the two stochastic processes. And on the right-hand side, you see the time step size. And you already see a little bit the relation that on the left-hand side, I have a square. On the right-hand side, I don't have a square, so it looks a little bit like an order of 1/2 for the strong convergence. But this is not already, this is one ingredient in the Euler scheme approximation, but the Euler scheme approximation is a little bit more complicated because there could be also propagation, error propagation. Yeah? So the next time step uses the previous time step, which is already maybe not correct, yeah, which is already a little bit further away from the solution, and so on. So we will use this thing in the proof, and the proof is actually then showing that we can control this kind of error propagation. So that was the second lemma I need in the proof. And the last one is Dupe's, it's not the last one. I also need the E2S isometry. The third one is the Dupe's martingale inequality, which we need. So let X denote a martingale. So X is a martingale E2 process. So if X is a martingale E2 process, this means that X has no dt part. So this means that dx is some sigma t x of t dw. Okay. Then it looks a little bit as if x is a Brownian motion. Yeah. So dx is dw with a scaling of the standard deviation sigma of tx, and this scaling can depend on the state. Yeah, but if you just consider maybe the Brownian motion as so sigma can maybe be different, yeah, depending on time and space, yeah, but it looks a little bit like a Brownian motion. Or maybe sometimes passes come back, I don't know, or go the other way around. Not always going like this. Actually, maybe I have a Brownian motion somewhere lying around. Let's see. So here is a plot of the passes of the Brownian motion. Yeah, so like this. Yeah. So if you have a Brownian motion, like this, so some passes. Okay. So then Dupe's martingale inequality tells me that for a p which you may choose, if you look at the maximum of x to the power of p, so we look here at the maximum over all times, then I can estimate this by a constant which depends on the p, which is given here, taking the last value. So x of capital T to the power of p. So if you take, for example, p equals to 2, yeah, then on the right-hand side, you have the variance. And on the left-hand side, you have not the maximum of the variances, but the expectation of the maximum. Yeah. Actually, it looks a little bit as if this tells us that if you look at this pth moment, yeah, so if you look at expectation of x to the power of p, then the maximum is attained or can be estimated by the last point in time. Yeah, so this here is my capital T, then the thing is only getting wider. Yeah. Compared to an earlier time. Okay, so I also need this that I can for a martingale, so you do not have a drift. Yeah, so with the drift, it could be different. You can have something like a mean reversion, which pulls all the paths back. Yeah. So maybe if you know what a mean reversion is, so not allowed here is a mean reversion. So a process with a mean reversion would look like dx is, say, some coefficients a, some level p minus x of t dt plus sigma dw. So whenever you are further away from b, yeah, it's pulling you back to the b. Yeah, you have a drift which always points to the b. So that would actually destroy this result, yes, that it's getting wider. So this is not allowed here. Okay, so I need this in the proof. And the last thing I need in the proof is the E2 isometry. So let phi denote some stochastic process, some adapted to the filtration of the pound in motion. Then you can estimate the expectation of the stochastic integral squared by the expectation of the square of the coefficient in a classical Lebesgue integral, so over dt. Okay, so recall that this is maybe also the thing, yeah. So actually I said estimate, but it's equal, yeah. So this is also the thing that tells you immediately that, for example, if you look at sigma 1 delta w t1 plus sigma 2 delta w t2, using time steps delta t1, delta t2, has, so on the left hand side, it's the variance of the integral. So now for the integral, I use two sums, two steps. Yeah. So the variance, so this guy has variance. Okay, it has variance sigma 1 squared delta t1 plus sigma 2 squared delta t2, which is the integral of sigma squared. Yeah, so in my example, sigma is piecewise constant, yeah, which is the right hand side. So I like to be a little bit illustrative on these lemmas I need. Yeah. So, but I believe the proofs you can find it in your classical lecture on stochastic process. So these are the ingredients we need to prove the strong convergence of the Euler scheme. So let's start with the theorem and the proof. So we assume that all the requirements for these lemmas are fulfilled. So we assume that mu and sigma satisfy a global Lipschitz condition. So we have some constant C such that we can estimate the coefficients in time and space. Okay, then we have the requirement for our lemma on the Lipschitz condition or Lipschitz continuity of stochastic processes. And also this implies the assumptions in lemma 47. Yeah, so both lemmas are fulfilled. Yeah, so we get this one here. And we also get this one here. Yeah, we have at most linear growth. Okay, and we have a Lipschitz condition in both arguments. Okay. Then we have convergence of x tilde to x, and we have strong order convergence 1/2. So this means we have that the supremum over all times from the difference of x of t and x tilde of t. From that, the expectation is smaller than a constant, which can depend on a lot of stuff, yeah, but does not depend on h, times 1/2, times h to the power of 1/2. Yeah? Okay, strong order 1/2, yeah, so it is 1 divided by square root of n, if you think in equidistributed time discretization using n time steps. Okay, so how can we prove this? So first, we use the notation and drop the n. Yeah? So I just prove the estimate. So x minus x tilde, supremum of this expectation is less than a constant times h. And first note that actually we can take the square inside and prove that this is smaller than h. Yeah, this follows directly from the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Okay, so what we like to prove, yeah, or what I will prove, is this estimate, and it follows from the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. So Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, expectation of f times g is smaller than square root of expectation f squared multiplied with square root of expectation g squared. And you use the Cauchy-Schwarz with f equals 1. Okay, so f equals 1. Then it's just on the left-hand side expectation of g. And this coefficient here, expectation of 1, is just a 1. And then it tells me expectation of g is smaller than the square root of expectation of g squared. Okay, and then I plug in for the g exactly our thing, which is inside the expectation. So the g is the supremum of x minus x tilde. So I get then supremum x minus x tilde squared, but the square of the supremum is equal to the supremum of the squared. So then I have that the square root of the expectation of the supremum of x minus x tilde squared is smaller than the square root of h, and I can take the squared and I have this estimate here. Okay, so we will prove this. And how do we prove this? Well, let's just plug in the definition of the stochastic processes. So if you have on the left-hand side, actually instead of supremum, I write maximum. Yeah, I can write maximum on the next slide. So let's do this here too. So if we like to, and maybe I use here a little t because later I like to integrate again, a little t and an s. Yeah, so I would use a different lemma, letter, sorry. If we like to estimate this, the maximum of the square of the difference, true solution Euler scheme, and from that the expectation, I can plug in the definition of the stochastic process. So x of s is x at the initial value plus the integral from 0 to s mu tau x tau d tau plus the integral 0 to s sigma tau x tau dw dw of tau. And from that we subtract x tilde, so minus x tilde. So here is the x tilde of s, so minus x tilde of zero. Okay, here it's minus mu tilde of tau, d tau. And here it is minus sigma tilde of tau, dw tau. Okay, from that we take the absolute value. So absolute value squared. Yeah, so I just plugged in the definition into this thing, and in front we have expectation of the maximum over all s. Yes, expectation over the maximum over all s. So maybe I move this a little bit further to the right. Oops, sorry. Hey, why is this not working? Okay, so let's move this a little bit further to the right. So I can write here expectation of the maximum s between 0 t. Okay, so that's the thing we have to estimate. And the idea we like to do here is to apply Cronwall's inequality. So actually, what was Cronwall's inequality? On the left-hand side, you have a function. On the right-hand side, you have an integral over the function. So it looks a little bit similar to this. On the left-hand side, I have a function, my error. On the right-hand side, I have integrals. Okay, integrals 0 to s. The x tilde of 0 minus x of 0 is 0 because we have the same initial value. So there are only the two integrals. So recall Cronwall's inequality. So what was this? If you have a function ut, and for this function ut, you have an estimate that this is smaller than some constant a plus b times the integral from 0 to t u of s ts, then you have the estimate. Okay, this looks a little bit like if you differentiate u prime is b times u, yeah? So it looks a little bit like having the ODE of an exponential function, and you can have this estimate. So ut is then estimated by a plus, oh, sorry, a times, so not plus, a times exponential bt. Okay, and we like to estimate the left-hand side by h. Yeah. So if we have here an h, and if we have here, note that our time is between 0 and capital T. Yeah. So if b is just a constant, I can estimate this by exponential b capital T. So if this is just a constant c of t, yeah, then we are actually done. So it means that everything is nice if we get something which has here an h plus And now for this plus, it is allowed that it is an integral over the function again. Okay, so in order to get this form, we are happy if we can move out an h, so the time step size, with a plus. And everything which remains should be an integral over the function again. And in order to have an integral over the function again, what we like is to move actually this integral here. Maybe I take a different color here. I like to move this integral in front. Yeah. So if I move this integral in front of this expectation, I can exchange integral and expectation. This is just a Fubini, but I have to move it in front of the absolute value squared, and I have to move it in front of the maximum. Yeah. If I move this, so move this in front of all this. And then inside, I can use now, for example, my Lipschitz condition to estimate mu of x with x. Yeah. So mu of x minus mu tilde, again, is an x minus x tilde. Then we are actually maybe done. So that's the main idea of this proof. Okay, so let's do this. So here on the slide, you see what I just did. Yeah. So on the left-hand side, we start with maximum x minus x tilde. And from that, the expectation. And I just plug in the definition of x tilde to get this. So this is our first step. We just plugged in the definition of x and x tilde. So now I have a sum inside a square, and I would like to move everything out a bit, so I can move the square in if I just use this estimate, yeah, which is a little bit like the triangle. A plus B plus C, yeah, so now I have three terms squared. I can estimate it by three times A squared plus B squared plus C squared. Okay, so if you use this, we can estimate these three terms inside the square as three squares. The maximum can be decomposed in three maximums. And the expectation is linear. So actually, I have three times expectation of the initial value difference. This guy here is zero, since we used x of zero equal x zero and x tilde of zero equal x zero. So the scheme has the same initial value. Okay, so this guy is zero. So what's left is we have three times, three doesn't matter, expectation over the maximum of the integral of the mu coefficient squared and maximum of the stochastic integral of the sigma squared. So what is left is need to estimate or to do is estimate these two integrals. So let's start with the first integral. Let's start with the drift term. Okay. So we use the Cauchy Schwarz again to move the square from the outside of the integral to the inside of the integral. Yeah, so I move here the square from the outside of the integral to the inside of the integral. So we use again the Cauchy Schwarz with one and the function g itself. Yeah, so then I have the integral over one, which gives me an additional s here. So this integral here over one gives me an additional s. Okay, then I can, if I take the maximum over all these s's, I can estimate this with a capital T. So maybe yeah, so if we have the maximum over these integrals, I have the maximum of the integral. Actually, it was the maximum of the difference of the two stochastic process, but we wrote the stochastic process as the integrals of the coefficients. So I have the maximum over the integrals. Yeah, but now since I moved the squared inside, the coefficient has here an absolute value squared. So actually it's positive. So the integral is positive. The integral is monotone. So taking the maximum is just take the last value. Yeah. And actually here I'm a bit brutal. Yeah, there could be also a little t here, but I just don't care. I take the capital T. Okay, so you see I have moved the squared inside and I have got rid of the maximum. Yeah. So my idea is I would like to move the integral out of the whole thing. Yeah. So let's move the integral to the front. So now I can use a Fubini. I can interchange expectation and integration, yeah, because the maximum is no longer in the way. And what do we have inside? Inside I have mu of t x, a mu of tau x of tau. Mu of tau x of tau minus mu tilde. And for that now we use the global Lipschitz condition, so our Lipschitz condition. So I can estimate this. So actually what is this? This is the mu of the true solution and the mu of the Euler scheme. The mu of the Euler scheme is, so this is now here important, is evaluated at x tilde with a different time. Yeah. So if I now use the global Lipschitz condition or the Lipschitz condition for the stochastic process, so here we use the Lipschitz condition to perform this estimate, I can say this is the difference in time. The difference in time is just because we are inside a time step, t minus ti. Yeah. So we use this only for tau inside the time step, because then I can write mu tilde of tau with the ti. And my x is at tau, my x tilde is at ti. So now I have two different processes, x is at tilde, and two different times. So I have to split this in x of tau minus x of ti, and then plus an x of ti minus x tilde ti. So now you see this is x at two different times, and it is x minus x tilde at the same time. So the first thing is just the other lemma which we had, a stochastic process as two different very close times. The other thing is again the expression which we had, but that's okay because we can use Kronwald's lemma. So that's okay because we can use Conway's lemma. So we just take then the maximum over all S's here. So it's okay to have this. It's okay since we use the Cornwall inequality. Yeah, so whenever we are under the integral, we are under the integral, we move the integral in front, it's okay to estimate the difference between x and x tilde with this maximum, because this will later be our function u in the Cornwall. But you have seen that here for the Cornwall, we have now a difference in time from our Lipschitz continuity, which gives us here an h. Yeah, so this is nice. We have here an h. Okay, so h plus our function again is okay for the Cornwall. So I need another h here, but this is just x at tau minus x at ti. So tau and ti is not far away. We have this estimate for stochastic processes that we can estimate this by the time step size. So if you go back, this is just the mu of x minus the mu tilde. So there's still a squared here, a squared around all this. So actually I have an h squared, and here for the x minus x of tau minus x of ti, I get a squared now. So this means we can apply this lemma here, where we have also a square here. And I can estimate this with an h. Okay, so I apply this lemma now. Okay, so now using here the square, we get an h square here. I have an integral over all times. I can estimate this with just a capital T. T is a constant. Then we have a square around this part here. Okay. We did this estimate for tau in the interval ti to ti plus one. But now if we integrate over all, this is a piecewise decomposition of the integral, so we get a sum over all partial integrals, and we get here this remainder, which is just our expression again, because we had Cornwall. We will use Cornwall. Okay, so now we apply the lemma, which I just flipped back. So we apply lemma 48, that we can also estimate this part here with an h. So I can interchange expectation and integration. So I have an h, and then I have an integral over t, which is just another constant t. So in sum, I can estimate the integral over the drift part. So this is the first integral we have to estimate by a constant times h plus the guy which we get had again on the left-hand side. Integral over the guy which we had on the left-hand side. Okay, so now time is almost up. I believe we started a bit later, but actually we are maybe done. I will now go a little bit quicker through the rest of the proof, because it is just analog, yeah, in the same way you can estimate the stochastic integral part. Yeah, so we can estimate the stochastic integral part. So we now use the two other lemmas, Itô is isometry and Dubbs Martingale inequality. So using using this, we get actually rid of the dw part. So using Itô isometry, yeah, you saw that we can replace the dw with a squared on the outside by a square on the sigma coefficient dt. Okay, so and now you see that these two lemmas gives us the bridge to do the same analog estimate for this part. Yeah? So we have now the analog estimate for this part, as we did here for the mu. Okay, so I do not want to do this again. Yeah, it's just this additional step in the front. And in sum, we have now an estimate which is of the form corresponding to the Cronwall's inequality. We have u is smaller than a constant times h plus a constant times the integral over u. So now we have the Cronwall inequality part here. Yeah. So this is Cronwall. Yeah. So our u is the maximum of xs minus x tilde s squared. Okay. So with Cronwall's inequality, we get that this is smaller than c times h exponential c times t. Okay, so maybe the last part was now quick, yeah, but I already motivated the Cronwall step, yeah, and the estimate for the sigma integral is exactly the same. So that was it, proving the strong convergence of the Euler scheme. So we now have strong convergence order 1/2. Yeah. So we started by squaring the left-hand side and get h on the right-hand side. So we have 1/2. We will prove next weak convergence order 1. Yeah. So we will prove this in one of our next sessions. And weak convergence is maybe the one which is of interest to us. You also saw it in the computer that we had weak convergence order 1. Thanks. That was it for this session.